Emmanuel, God with us. I am so glad that God is with us. I stand this morning in awe and utter amazement that the Lord has been so kind and gracious, long-suffering to usward, not willing that anyone would perish. It is God and God alone that has brought us all the way from January 1 up until December the 27th. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Bless his holy name and forget not all of his benefits. Oh, give God glory. Hallelujah. I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. Oh, magnify the Lord with me. Come on, Fort Foot and family. Let us exalt his name together. My heart is beating with energy and excitement this morning. It's amazing. It's been a year like none other, a one that we would like to forget some of its components and aspects, but the Lord has allowed our golden moments to roll on just a little while longer. So we come to give him glory, honor, and praise this morning. I greet you in the blessed Holy Ghost name of Jesus Christ. Wow. We almost through this year. 4 more days in 2020 will be history. Hallelujah. Give God glory. Be so kind if you will this morning to meet me in Isaiah 61. There was a word for our hearts on this last Sunday of 2020. The eagle-eyed prophet writes in the prophetic perfect tense, meaning that he often speaks of distant future events, but he does so in the past tense of God's divine certainty, as if the future event had already occurred decades ago. It reads as follows. The Spirit of the Lord God is upon me, because the Lord has anointed me to preach good tidings unto the meek. He has sent me to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives, and the opening of the prison to them that are bound, to proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord and the day of vengeance of our God, to comfort all that mourn, to appoint unto them that mourn in Zion, to give unto them beauty for ashes, the oil of joy for mourning, the garment of praise for the spirit of heaviness, that they might be called trees of righteousness, the planting of the Lord, that he might be glorified. And they shall build the old wastes, they shall raise up the former desolations, and they shall repair the waste cities, the desolations of many generations. And strangers shall stand and feed your flocks, and the sons of the alien shall be your plowmen and your vine dressers. But ye shall be named the priests of the Lord. Men shall call you the ministers of our God. Ye shall eat the riches of the Gentiles, and in their glory shall ye boast yourselves. For your shame ye shall have double, and for confusion they shall rejoice in their portion. Therefore, in their land, they shall possess the double. Everlasting joy shall be unto them. For the Lord loved judgment. I hate robbery for burnt offerings, and I will direct their work in truth, and I will make an everlasting covenant with them. And their seed shall be known among the Gentiles, and their offspring among the people. All that see them shall acknowledge them, that they are the seed which the Lord has blessed. I will greatly rejoice in the Lord. My soul shall be joyful in my God, for he hath clothed me with the garments of salvation. He has covered me with the robe of righteousness, as a bridegroom decketh herself with ornaments, and as a bride adorneth herself with her jewels. For as the earth bringeth forth her bud, and as the garden causeth the things that are sown in it to spring forth, so the Lord God will cause righteousness and praise to spring forth before all the nations. May the Lord add a blessing to the readers, hearers, and doers of his holy and precious word. Eternal God, our Father, we thank you for your goodness and your mercy. You have truly given us blessings this year that have been pressed down, shaken together, and running over in the midst of life's trials and tribulations. May your name be praised in all the earth. May we proclaim your glory among the heathen, and your wonders among all people. It's in the mighty, precious, resurrected name of Jesus that we pray. And all of God's family said amen and bless the Lord. Consider with me this morning, in the last Sunday of 2020, from the subject, beauty for ashes. Beauty for ashes. Israel had declined into a dark, desperate place. They had turned away from God, had hewn out cisterns that can hold no water. They had become apostasy and guilty of not honoring the true and living God. Live into this text with me, if you will. Isaiah prophesied about this event in Isaiah 61, perhaps 700 to 800 years prior to it occurring. If you can imagine this morning, you were sitting in Fort Foot Baptist Church or any other church of the living God, and the service began with a normal Jewish invocation, followed by a prayer and a reading of Deuteronomy, a confession of faith, and then they gave the scroll to Jesus. And he opened up to Isaiah 61 and said, with a voice that probably sounded like mighty rushing waters, "The Spirit of the Lord God is upon me, because the Lord has anointed me to preach the gospel, good tidings unto the meek. He has sent me to bind up the broken heart, to proclaim liberty to the captives, and the opening of the prison to them that are bound, to proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord." And Luke chapter 4 says he closed the book and sat down. Somebody said, you and I today live between the parentheses. We live between the what? We live between the parentheses. It's the acceptable year of the Lord. But he did not say from Luke chapter 4 about the day of vengeance. Prophetically, we live between the 69th and 70th week in the prophetic book of Daniel. We live between the 69th and 70th week in the prophetic book of Daniel. You'll catch that as you continue your study in the Word of God. This was Jesus coming to speak in the temple, in the synagogue. Jeremiah gives us some help. Chapter 17, verse 1 of Jeremiah said, Judah's heart was engraved with a pen of iron and the point of a diamond. It was graven upon the table of their heart. Really what Jeremiah was saying, Israel, the children of God, had become so hard-hearted, their hearts were hard like a tombstone. Jeremiah 17:9 goes on to say, the heart is deceitful and above all things, desperately wicked. Who can know it? Chapter 17, verse 10, God said, I, the Lord, searches the heart. Ezekiel 36 gives further clarity. Ezekiel 36, verse 26 says, a new heart also will I give you, and a new spirit I will put within you. I will take away your stony heart, give you a heart of flesh, and a new spirit. No wonder David cried out in Psalm 51:10, create in me a clean heart, renew in me a right spirit, then I'll teach transgressors your ways, sinners shall be converted. The more I read the Word of God, the more it becomes a living translation. No matter what translation I'm reading, it comes alive. The Word becomes flesh and lives among us. How is it that in your last days in office, you will pardon a murderer who's guilty of war crimes, the killing of innocent civilian children, men, and women? The text says they had hearts that were like tombstones that could be engraved upon. How is it that you're supposed to be serving the people of God that puts you in office, in the Oval Office, over 300,000 have died. Millions are infected. Millions are having food deserts. They are hungry. 1 in 6 in some places, 1 in 4 in others. And you don't seem to care. It's because the heart is hard. One philosopher put it this way. The heart of the problem is a problem of the heart. But I come by to tell you this morning that even if one has a heart like a tombstone, the God that we serve says, I come and the Spirit of the Lord is upon me. He has anointed me to preach the gospel, good tidings to the humble, to the poor. That means poor in economic terms, but it also could mean piety. Those that are devoted, those are devout, those that have a reverence and a awe and a fear of God in the holy sense. The Spirit of the Lord. If you read even in the Old Testament, the Holy Spirit was here in the Old Testament, you know. In the Old Testament, the Holy Spirit would come to empower one, and once the miraculous act had been completed, the Holy Spirit would leave. But thanks be to God, on the day of Pentecost, the Holy Spirit came in full to empower us to do great and mighty things in the sight of the Lord, and it never left us. It came in full, and it came to say, anytime you see the phrase, the Spirit of the Lord, you know something powerful is about to happen. Isaiah prophesied that this will be Jesus speaking on that grand day. And some 700 to 800 years later, it occurred just as Isaiah prophesied. The mandate was the fact that the Spirit of the Lord was upon him. He was and is the Spirit of God, Jesus. He was anointed, endowed, and endued with power from on high to preach, Greek word kereso, to proclaim the glory of the Lord to the heathen, the wonders of God to the whole world. Everybody needs to hear the gospel of Jesus Christ. Look at the message. He sent him to bind up the brokenhearted. Lord have mercy, this text is real this morning. Millions of families have been touched by this virus. Thousands of families are mourning and grieving as I speak this morning. But Jesus said, I came to bind up the brokenhearted. Sometimes when our hearts are broken, at least they are open to hear what thus said the Lord. Sad point of the commentary of this text says that they said, wait a minute, is not this Joseph's son? Is not he the son of a carpenter? They said, do some miracles here like you did back in Canaan. They were blind, but did not receive the truth. If your heart is broken this morning, I got good news. Jesus said, I came to bind up your broken heart. I'll put your heart back together so you can love again. You must begin to by loving God with all of your heart, all of your soul, and with all of your mind. Money is all right, but it's not guaranteed to heal a broken heart. Disappointment, despair, depression, and disillusionment flood our hearts this year unlike never before. But Jesus says, if you give me your heart, I'll bind it up, I'll put it back together like the best cardiologist so you can love and live again. Verses 1 through 3 talks about freedom to live. In him we live, move, and have our being. You can't solve a broken heart by drinking a gallon of alcohol, smoking a ton of marijuana. You need Jesus. He's our divine cardiologist. He came to bind up the brokenhearted. He came to proclaim liberty to the captives, those that have been in exile are now set free. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. No matter what you are bound to this blessed Sunday morning, no matter what or who is trying to hold you hostage, I stop by to tell you, once you give your life to Jesus Christ, you will be free to live, free to sing, free to have the joy of the Lord. He gives a peace that passes all understanding. You'll have a joy that is unspeakable. Beauty for my ashes. Oh, today, while millions unfortunately are unemployed. Dreams have not only been deferred or delayed, they have been destroyed. Businesses are closing. Hard work and labor seems not to matter in some cases. Despair, devastation like never before, even worse than 1929 in the Great Depression. Folk are heartbroken, distraught, feeling like I'm a prisoner of this society. Does anybody care? Jesus said, cast all your cares on me, for I care for you. You are still precious in my sight. He wants to heal your brokenhearted. Oh, if the world would hear what thus saith the Lord. Stop trying to find false panaceas and cures for a broken heart. It only can happen in Jesus Christ. He said, I'll give you a new heart. I'll take away your stony heart. I'll give you a heart of flesh. You got to trust me and depend on me. Lean not to your own understanding, but in all of your ways acknowledge me, and I will direct your paths. This is good news, my friend. Beauty for my ashes. Opening of the prison to them that are bound. Let me borrow your imagination for just 30 seconds. I'll give it back to you in a minute. If you and I were incarcerated in a jailhouse this morning, and the warden came in and said, there's a strange man at the gate. He has a voice that sounds like mighty rushing waters. He got hair that looked like lamb's wool. His feet look like polished brass as if they've been burned in a furnace. He said, everybody in the jail, everybody in the prison has been set free. I will come and be incarcerated, suffer for your sake. You are free. Can you imagine the joy? Can you imagine the jubilation for just 1 minute? Proclaim liberty to the captives, opening of the prisons all around the world to them that are bound. He says, I come to proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord and the day of vengeance of our God to comfort all that mourn. To appoint to them that mourn in Zion, to give to them beauty for ashes. Here we go. Beauty for ashes. Can I teach for just a minute? In the Jewish funeral, they would cover their head with ashes and weep and mourn and lament. Israel, like America, was in one sense preparing for a funeral. But Jesus said, I want you to change your clothes. They got the information wrong. You're not going to a funeral. I need you to put on your wedding clothes. He gives a striking dichotomy. Beauty for your ashes. I want to give you praise for your pain. Joy for your judgment. Deliverance for your despair. If you call on the name of the Lord, he will answer. Proverbs 15:29 said, the Lord is far from the wicked, but he heareth the prayers of the righteous. You got to cry out to God in the moment of a despair. God, I'm going through right now. He said, I know you're going through. I know your sorrows. I hear your cry. I see your affliction, and I come to deliver. I come to give you beauty for your ashes, for all of your brokenness. I want to give you a blessing for all of your hurt. I want to give you a hallelujah. You're going to sing to the glory of the Lord. You're going to be able to enter into my gates with thanksgiving, into my courts with praise. Oh, give God glory. Sometimes in the midst of my ashes, I get a new perspective. I get a new sense of reverence. I get a new sense of awe for the God that I serve. He promised never to leave me, never to leave me alone. Beauty for my ashes. The oil of joy for your mourning. Take off the grave clothes. Take the shackles off my feet so I can dance. Stop being sorrowful. Fill your heart with songs. I come to lift up your bowed down head. I will look to the hills when cometh my help, because all of my help cometh from the Lord. God, by faith we receive your beautiful ashes. It's been a long, long, long year. Looked like this year would never come to the end. He says, in one sense, it's going to be your year of jubilee. Everything that you lost, not only am I going to give it back, I'm going to give you double for your trouble. Your blessings will be pressed down, shaken together, and running over. When I look back over this year, I know it was nobody but the Lord who kept me out of harm's way, who kept me out of trouble. When my mind would drift from time to time, he said, come on back. You got my name on the line. The blood has blotted out all of your transgressions. What can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood. He gave me beauty for my ashes. David said, like Israel, I deserved to be going to a funeral. But by the amazing grace and the infinite mercy of God, he told me to take off the grave clothes, put on my wedding clothes. In the funeral, I told you they put ashes on their head to weep, lament, and mourn. But for a funeral, they put on a garland of flowers to celebrate lively, bright colors. And oftentimes, the clothes that they wore showed their status and their occasion. He gives all of joy for mourning, the garment of praise for the spirit of heaviness. Truth be told, in 2020, all of us that are living and breathing have had some moments of heaviness. You cough more than 3 times in an hour. You said, do I have it? Am I infected? Is it a virus? Am I going to live? My head stopped aching for 3 days. I said, am I going to die? Or am I going to live? He says, I'm going to move you from a ventilator to victory, either on this side or on the other side of glory. Beauty for ashes. They were, at first, excited in adoration. But then, sadly, the people there in the synagogue went from being advocates and excited in adoration to became antagonistic. Augustine, the African Bishop of Hippo, said it this way. Augustine, the African Bishop of Hippo, he said, folk like it when the gospel enlightens them, but they become antagonized when it accuses and convicts them. Can you imagine not Lyle's preaching, not Jake's preaching, not in a bishop or potentate on the human realm preaching, but Jesus preaching this sermon? He said, the rabbis recognized by now that he was talking about the Messiah, and they were fine with that as long as they thought he was talking about somebody else. But Jesus really said, no, I am the Messiah. I am the one that the Spirit of the Lord is upon. I am the one that's been highly anointed. I am the one who's preaching good tidings of the gospel of Jesus Christ that can save from the guttermost to the uttermost. I am the one that come to bind up your broken heart. I am the one that gives you liberty, no longer have you to be a captive. I am the one who openeth the prison to them that are bound. I am proclaiming as we speak, said Jesus, the year of the Lord, the acceptable year of the Lord. What it's saying is this: the worst, awful, evil, wicked, sagacious, pernicious, violent criminal can still be saved under the blood of Jesus Christ, because we are still living in the parenthesis in between the acceptable year of the Lord while grace and mercy prevail, until the day of vengeance comes when mercy and grace and all of that will have been gone. 1 Peter 3:12 says, God looks upon the righteous, but he turns his face against the wicked. Sometimes men on this side, women, boys, and girls on this side of the Jordan, act like they'll never have to pay for their sin, for their evilness, for their wickedness. Oh, but judgment day is coming. You're going to have to pay for every sin that you committed in this flesh if you don't know the Lord. Jesus makes us free to live. I'm trying to get past verse 3, but the beauty for ashes. All of joy. God knows we need some joy. Sometimes you have to turn off the television that's telling more bad, heartbreaking news. put on the garment of praise for our spirit of heaviness. God, help us. You said in Psalm 46, you'd be a very present help in a time of trouble. We need you right now. We are a nation in perilous times. They used to be for centuries now, since the beginning of this nation, a peaceful transition of power. But now we are caught up in a hurricane, a tornado, a typhoon. Men and women who are called to serve the people of God are hushed, their cowardice mouths in silence, will not speak out against wrong, will not say a word for the Lord. Can somebody have a spine? Can somebody have an ounce of courage? Can somebody have an ounce of compassion? Can somebody say something? God, I know you got a remnant somewhere that will speak to the issues of our times. While we rejoice, most of us, because God has been so good, it ought to break our hearts because millions are struggling like never before, and it's not even necessary. But God is our only hope. We're trusting in you. Our hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and his righteousness. We dare not trust the sweetest frame, wholly lean on Jesus' name. God, by faith, we claim beauty for our ashes. We receive your anointing oil of joy for our mourning. We receive the garment of praise, which is your righteousness, for the spirit of heaviness, that we might be called trees of righteousness. Psalm 1 says we should be like a tree planted by the rivers of water that shall bring forth our fruit in our season, and our leaves shall not wither, and whatsoever we do it shall prosper. Free to live. God, thank you for bringing us. God, thank you for keeping us. God, we thank you for allowing us to track through this trial and tribulation. Yes, it has been tough. It has been unprecedented. It has been rough going, and sometimes in spaces and places. But you have kept us together. We thank God for the loving, caring family, the Fort Foot Baptist Church, who has stayed together through this last 9 months in particular. Thank you, Fort Foot, for how you supported God's ministry, how you kept giving, how you kept sharing, how you kept loving, how you kept showing the love of Jesus Christ, even in these dark and difficult days. Case in point, just a couple of weeks ago, your church, our church, gave out over 150 baskets, seemingly tons of food, to try to do a small part to help in this time in which we live. Now more than ever, we that know the Lord must be the church of the living God. We must be the beacon light in a dark city. We must be intentional and consistent in sharing and showing the love of Jesus Christ to help folk know that God still cares. Somebody said, and I understand, if God is love, why all the hate? If God is so good, why all the bad? These are existential questions that emerge out of our soul surveil. Sometimes it causes me to wonder when it seems to some humans that God is so far away, but I stop by to tell you, he's a right here God. You have to cry out to him and receive beauty for your ashes. Come on, help me out. Give it to Jesus. Some scriptures bring us a great deal of comfort and succor. And truth be told, sometimes other scriptures challenge us. such as Romans 8:28 that says, all things work together for good of them that love God and are called according to his purpose. As much as this hurt, as much as this causes me to grieve and to mourn and to suffer, how can this be working for my good? Sometimes as mere humans, it's difficult for us not to think just on the temporary and the earthly realm when God is working on a realm of eternity. May the Spirit of the living God rest in your heart this morning. May you hear the word of God. God is going to bind up your broken heart. And once by faith God binds up your broken heart, you will be joyful and be able to help someone else to have their broken heart healed. He says in Luke chapter 4, the prophecy that Isaiah spoke came to pass. He said, I come to heal the brokenhearted. Somebody say, heal. I came to deliver. Somebody say, deliver. Watch this. Luke chapter 4, latter part of verse 18. Recovering of sight to the blind. We often take so much for granted, may need glasses to see, finer print, but imagine being blind. And now you wake up on December 27 and God says, I'm going to restore your sight. Would you be shouting all over the DMV? They would hear you all the way in La Puente, California, New York, New Jersey, Delaware, California, Mississippi. You'd be praising God, going in and coming out with your whole heart because you once were blind, but now you see. You were lost, but now you're found. Can you see the power of this text? Recovering of sight to the blind, liberty to them that are bruised. It is your jubilee when men will turn their hearts back to their families, property that has been lost to be restored, houses that went to foreclosure are returned to the owner, the land will rest as well as your soul. Because Jesus says, I give you beauty for your ashes, all of joy for mourning. Pastor, you just told us that a minute ago. I want you to hear it and let it seep deep in your soul. Time for the garment of praise. We are almost through this year, on our way to a year of hope and blessings and holiness and righteous living. Planting of the Lord. Allow God to plant you and flourish right where you are. Allow God to give you and me new hearts of flesh, so we can rejoice and have our beauty for ashes. Free to live, then they'll be free to serve. Verse 4 through 7 says, they shall build the old ways, they shall raise up the former desolations, and they shall reappear the waste cities, the desolations of many generations. God says, I'm going to give you beauty for ashes so you can live. I'm going to bind up your broken heart. Sometimes those hearts that have been broken, you wonder why some folk seem to praise God so loud and so strong. You might say to yourself, it don't take all of that, but you don't know all that they've been through. You don't know how long they've been broken, how distraught they were, how devastated they were. And now God is bringing them out of the muck and the miry clay, placing their feet on a rock to stay so they can't help but praise God. When I think of the goodness of the Lord and all that is done for you and me, our souls cry out, glory, hallelujah. I was badly bent and broken in my spirit. Didn't ever think I'd love again. Think I spent the rest of my life by myself, but God blessed me with a loving God-sent companion. We were homeless, but now we got an apartment. We got a place to live. We were hungry, but now there's food on our table. Our clothes are ragged. Now we got new clothes in the closet. You don't know like I know what the Lord has done for me, so I got to give God praise. I will bless the Lord at all times. His praises shall continually be in my mouth. Oh, magnify the Lord with me. Let us exalt his name together. He gave me beauty for my ashes. I was a wretch undone, and I wasn't fit to live, but I wasn't fit to die. But Jesus came in, saved my soul, gave me a new mind,
put my feet on a path called straight, put love in my heart, joy in my spirit, hearing in my ears, compassion in my heart. Oh God, I give your name glory. I give your name honor, because you and you alone are worthy to be praised. Your name is worthy to be praised above all other names. At the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow, every tongue shall confess. Why are you praising God so much? He gave me beauty for my ashes. I was at a low point, broke, busted, and disgusted. Oh, but the name of Jesus gave me joy when I think about it, giving me peace that passes all understanding. He gave me beauty for my ashes, all of joy for my mourning, garment of praise for my righteousness. You ever come to a point you can't really express what you feel on the inside, but you know it's Jesus still working? So, brothers and sisters, we can't rest on our laurels and past victories. We have to build the old ways. There's much waste and despair and rottenness all around us, but God has blessed us so we can be free to not just live, but free to serve. Isaiah calls Jesus servant of God. What a blessing somebody would identify you and me as servants of the true and living God. So we can build up the old ways. Old things can pass away and all things can become new. We can raise up the former desolations. There's desolation all around us. Our cities are going to ruin because we're not trusting in the Lord. The desolation in all of our families for many generations, but it's time to stop the curse and start the praise. Strangers will stand and feed your flock. They shall your plowmen and your vine dressers be. Look at verse 6 of Isaiah 61 as I move closer to the end. But ye shall be named the priests of the Lord. There it is. We are a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a peculiar people, as in a rare treasure unto God, who've been called out of darkness, and now we walk in the marvelous light. We are priests of the Lord. Priests and priestess show people, lead people, guide people, love people to Jesus. That's what we're called to do. He emphasizes again in 6b, we shall be called ministers of God. Ministry is more than a title, it's a task. Like Psalm 40 when he said, I delight to do your will, God. I was in a horrible place, but I found a rock of ages. We are the priests of the Lord. We shall be ministers of our God. You don't need a title. You're saved. You are a minister and a priest of the Lord. Verse 7, as I close. For your shame ye shall have double, and for confusion they shall rejoice in their portion. Therefore, in the land they shall possess the double. Everlasting joy shall be unto them. By faith I hear God saying this to all of us. For all of your trouble in 2020, your joy is going to be double. And it won't be temporary. It would be everlasting joy. So God, here I stand, as the old deacon would say, head bowed and body bent, heart broken, an empty pitcher before your full fountain. Fill me, spill me, use us for your glory. We want to experience the double joy for our trouble. Praise for our problems, hallelujah for our heartbreaks, joy for our judgment. We receive beauty for ashes. You will have us to look back and reflect on some of the dark moments of 2020. And now you can use that to help us to rejoice, be happy ourselves, and to be so full of God's spirit that it becomes contagious and spiritually, on a positive note, infectious, so that others see, how can you be so happy Why is it that you got so much joy? Are you just living in a fantasy world? No, I've got the joy of the Lord. It's because of Jesus. I gave him all of my ashes because I'm not going to a funeral. I choose to live. He said, I came that you might have life, that you might have it more abundantly. Thank you, Jesus, for taking us through 2020 by faith. Thank you, Jesus, for giving us beauty for our ashes. What you'll find, and I speak this from experience, some things that look like, and at one perspective, they were ashes. They were painful. They were hurtful. God has used them to help me grow in the spirit. Because, see, if I'd never had a problem, I wouldn't know God could resolve it. If I'd never been down, I couldn't testify, preach, and teach that he'll pick you up, turn you around, put your feet on a street called straight. If I'd never been sad, I couldn't sing with the joy of the Lord. If I never had a pain, I couldn't preach with power on the anointing God. But all those things have helped to make you and I better for the Lord. Jesus closed the book and sat down. Because we live in the parenthesis, we are still living in the acceptable year of the Lord. But we are living between his first coming and his second coming. You do know he's coming back. We want to get our house in order. May God bless you. Receive his beauty for your ashes. We'll be back on New Year's Eve with the closing message for this blessed year of 2020. Please join us. I believe on New Year's Eve we'll convene about 10:45. It'll be live streamed from the Fort Foot Baptist Church studios. In the meantime, before I forget, if you don't know this Jesus, sometimes he allows ashes so we can cry out for his beauty. Sometimes he allows sorrows that will lead us to salvation. Sometimes he allows real so we can get to redemption. Give him your ashes. Receive his beauty. Our loving anointed counselors are waiting to receive your call today. They'll take a moment to pray with you, to lead you to the beauty of salvation in Jesus Christ. Don't let 2021 pass and find you still lost. While you have time, cry out to Jesus. He knows all about your brokenness and your despair. You don't have to be held captive by any past sin. He doesn't want you to be held hostage. You are not a hostage. You are an heir of God and a joint heir with Jesus Christ. Today is a day of salvation. He said, in the day you hear my voice, don't harden your heart. Give your life to Jesus Christ. Receive the precious gift of salvation today. It's getting cold outside. No, it's already cold. We at the 4 Foot Family partner in ministry with the Salvation Army mission. We have a nice big bin outside of the church in the parking lot. Those nice coats, sweaters, jackets that you no longer need. You can be a double blessing today. It would help someone to get addiction counseling and deliverance, and also clothes to wear for those who are less fortunate. You can bring them and open up our nice bin and we'll deposit them. It will be a blessing to somebody today. Let's fill it up before the year closes. It sounded kind of empty this morning when I made a drop in. Let's fill it up with those coats, jackets, sweaters. They are needed because it's cold. You can help be a part of somebody's deliverance that you don't even know about. We are blessed to be a blessing. They are going through their ashes, but we can help to give them
the beauty of Jesus Christ. May God bless you. A special shout out to our hardworking Anointed Media Ministry who've been tracking with us for the last 42 virtual weeks as the Word of God has come from God's house to your house. Can you give God praise? They have labored tirelessly. Some of them have been there for most, if not all, of the 42 virtual weeks and before. So we thank you for your service. Love you, Fort Foot. Miss you. We concluded in a Bible study this week, Philippians chapter 4. And I said to the ministry team there that Paul loved the church at Philippi almost as much as I loved the members of Fort Foot. May God bless you. May heaven smile upon you as we think on beauty for ashes. Until New Year's Eve, be blessed. May the love of Jesus, the joy of Jesus, the peace that passes all understanding, flood your heart, souls, and minds today. In the mighty name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Hallelujah.
Thank you, Pastor Lyles, for that wonderful word. We pray that it touched your heart.
Now is the time that we would like to invite you to know Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior. If you have never accepted Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior and would like to do so today, or if you or someone you know is in need of prayer, there is a number that will come across the screen where you can speak with one of our altar counselors. They are there, willing, able, and desiring to serve you. Please feel free to reach out. The lines will remain open for 2 hours, and we pray that you have a blessed day.
We'll be back here next week. Hope to see you there.
Amen.
Until then, walk with the King and be a blessing to others. God bless you.
God bless. Amen.
Appreciate it.
A mystery.
It's amazing how
your patience with me, God will never leave.
You don't give up on me.
Don't ever leave.
Help me.
Help me to see like you.
Like you.
No matter what I go through.
Hey.
Everything's working for my good for a way.
Let me tell you what he does.
He saves the day.
And he will.
He will come through.
Hallelujah.
Superheroes.
Don't pray to love. A love like this
makes my heart beat.
And I promise you,
all I wanna do is make you proud of me.
That's why
I don't wanna love nobody but you. I don't wanna love nobody but you.
Yes.
I don't wanna love nobody but you.
I searched all over.
I don't wanna love nobody but you.
You.
I don't wanna love nobody but you.
That's right.
I don't wanna love nobody. Love nobody but you.
And the church sang, come on. Jesus loving you
will be the death of me.
It sounds crazy, don't it?
Hey. That's how it's supposed to be.
Let me tell you what it means.
More than less of me.
That's why.
I don't want to love nobody but you. I don't wanna love nobody but you.
Father,
I don't wanna love nobody but you.
I really mean it this time.
I don't wanna love nobody but you.
Jesus.
I don't wanna love nobody but you. I don't wanna love nobody but you.
Let me tell you what it does.
He saves the day.
Come on.
He will come through.
He will let you down, but
he won't. That's not what superheroes do.
See, I will never find
no greater love.
A love like this.
All I wanna do is make you proud of me.
Let me say it again.
He saves the day.
Savior.